Thank you. Thank you. As you can see, the room is very full, so I just want to say that we have two other lecture halls. It's number 3 and 9, so if you want to have a place to sit, you can go to these two other lecture halls, and we have a live stream there, so you can see everything there as well. And on these stairs, there's officially only one person allowed per step. And that's about everything I want to say. So in a couple of minutes, the program starts. Thank you.
Das war dann die Meine Nachbarn. Nein, nein, nicht so richtig. Aber die waren, also die haben gerade die Sachen. Ja, genau. Also ich weiß nicht, ob Sarah da dabei ist. Die war auch kurz nach Hause gefahren. Okay. Das ist.
Thank you.
liebe Teilnehmerinnen und Teilnehmer,
Participants,
liebe Referentinnen und Referenten,
speakers,
liebe Gäste.
We'd like to warmly welcome you to the 4th International Conference on Degrowth for Ecological Sustainability and Social Equity. My name is Daniel Konstein, and my name is Nina Treu. And we're delighted to be able to welcome you on behalf of the entire organizing team. We are looking forward to 5 exciting days together with you here in Leipzig. This conference is dedicated to all of us, those of us who question the endless growth paradigm, and those of us who want to overcome that growth paradigm. And we are obviously more than many think, including the organizing team in the beginning. In total, we are more than 3,000 people that are participating in this conference. And there are many more who wanted to get a ticket, but couldn't get one anymore because we closed registration. We're also much more diverse than the term degrowth would suggest. So questioning the growth paradigm involves more milieus is suggested by terms such as degrowth. And degrowth shows something and expresses the personal pursuit of the good life, and it combines it with the collective pursuit of the good life. So the degrowth movement has become stronger since the first degrowth conference 6 years ago. Paris, Barcelona, Venice and Montreal all saw a rise in the number of participants, but we never saw more participants than 1,000. And there is a huge interest in the critique of growth, and that was visible already in 2011 when the conference titled Beyond Growth was organized here in Berlin. There, the discussion whether or not overcoming the growth paradigm was necessary and possible, I think we can answer this with a yes. And that is why we want to connect the degrowth debate of Southern Europe with the critique of growth and many other alternatives that are practiced around the world. We want to build bridges. Together with you, we want to think, try, and also try out how we can overcome the growth paradigm. And it is very important to us to be able to welcome you here in this place, because even though there is a higher interest in the critique of growth, Germany remains one of the centers of the contradictions. We're exporting that growth model and that development model all around the world. And through our economy, we are overstepping the boundaries of the planet, and we're focusing our policies on fulfilling growth needs and the growth imperative. We are convinced that a society that is based on growth has no future. And that's why we have to come together and build an economy beyond a growth that allows us to have a good life for all. And we particularly decided to have this conference in Leipzig because it embodies many of the contradictions of the growth questions. There is a hype around Leipzig. It is referred to as Leipzig, and it is portrayed as a successful and growing metropolis. At the same time, it is marked by experiences of shrinking as well as current struggles around the city for all. And there is a very diverse project scene that puts degrowth into practice in many places. And in that sense, Leipzig is a very fascinating and diverse backdrop for our conference. Of course, we also hope that the conference will have a positive effect on the city as well. So, in a sense, there are many good reasons for us to come together here. And nevertheless, we were very concerned in the organizing team over the past 2 years that we would become so many that it wouldn't be possible to really find out to get to some level of clarity about what degrowth means for us, that this conference would actually blur or obscure what unites us in our diversity. And that's why we would like all of us, that interested people from the public, scientists, practitioners, activists, and so on, that we use this conference as an opportunity to deal with our diversity in a positive way. Our diversity is the breeding ground for the mosaic that is degrowth. That is why we want to provide a space with a diversity of formats as well, so that you can have a rich and a fruitful exchange beyond your own ideas and opinions. We hope that you will be able to use these spaces in order to enrich it by becoming involved yourself and enriching the mosaic that is degrowth. When in the beginning, at the end of 2012, we decided to have the Degrowth Conference here in Germany, we embarked upon a huge experiment. We come from different activist backgrounds, we have different organizations. Our organizing team that is that operates in a grassroots democracy way had to be put together. It wasn't there from the start. We received much support from research and degrowth, the initiators of the degrowth conferences, and the organizers of the conference Beyond Growth. But in the beginning, only few of us had experience with organizing such a huge conference. But thanks to the relentless work, hard work of the and for the most part, voluntary organizing team and all the supporting and partnering organizations and the many submissions on the many volunteers, all this has become possible. Degrowth was never meant to be only a title of a conference, but it was to inform the way in which we would organize this conference as well. So from the beginning, we said that budget should not be able to decide who can attend this conference and who not. You took part in this experiment. You were able to decide what you wanted to pay as a conference fee. And this experiment was successful, this part of the experiment, because we received more in conference fees than we expected per person. So it is possible to organize a conference relying on the solidarity and the honesty of over 3,000 people. We would wish that there will be more of these positive experiences during the conference as well. And we're curious to see what you will learn, who you will meet, new contacts you will have, and more questions and more ideas, new ideas that you will have, and how we can together continue our struggle for a world beyond growth. And we hope that these next 5 days will be very enriching and exciting for us, and will help us to have very courageous visions, and will inspire us to experiment, to continue to experiment. Before we start with our opening plenary, before the opening lectures by Alberto Acosta and Naomi Klein, we want to give you a short outlook on the program and a few technical remarks. Well, first of all, a few things on the program. So we have dramaturgical steps in this conference. Tomorrow, our theme is critique and resistance and how we can oppose the crisis, followed by how we can, what are our alliance, opportunities for alliances, potentials for alliance, and the next day on Friday will be how to build a degrowth society. So tomorrow and the following 2 days, we will have two keynotes at 9 o'clock. We'll have half an hour break, and then from 11 to 1, we have panel discussions, scientific sessions, workshops, arts events, and so on. We'll have a lunch break from 1 to 2:30, followed by another session with parallel events from 2:30 to 4:30. Between 5 and 7, we'll have the interactive formats, such as the group assembly process and the open space. This is where you will actively participate also. and contribute with your ideas. We'll have an evening break from 7 to 8, and followed by another panel or more panel discussions and evening lectures and book presentations and cultural events. And we also have a fair for degrowth, which allows more than 50 organizations that are committed to the degrowth idea to give participants a feeling of what they do. So there's a wide variety of offers and displays, such as information and book stands and elaborate arts installations, and also a mysterious phone booth. So please check it out. There's good news and bad news about the food. The good news is that Le Sabot will provide us with vegan, organic, and seasonal meals for lunch and dinner here right outside in the courtyard. Le Sabot is a mobile, open, interactive kitchen, and they're using locally produced vegetables from the Solidarity Collective Rote Beete. So what's the bad news? The bad news is we have a lunch break of 1.5 hours, and almost all of us want to eat. Le Sabot can cook for 2,000, which is remarkable, but it's not enough for all of us. So we have to be prepared that there will be long lines, and maybe not all of us will be able to eat in the courtyard. So what can you do? Please be patient. Maybe you can have a conversation, enjoy a conversation, or you can check out other places to eat in the city center or here in the university dining hall. If you have a student identity card or university employee card, you can have a meal there for affordable prices as well. And one more thing. Degrowth is an interactive conference that relies on the active participation of all of you. We need your support. We're talking about a few hours, so if you want to help out, it's more than welcome, and please contact the volunteers at the Helpers Coordination Stand right outside the Audimax in the entrance area. So we don't want to keep you waiting any longer. The presentations by Alberto Acosta and Naomi Klein will last about 45 minutes. We won't have questions and answers, unfortunately, followed by a musical presentation, another musical presentation by the same artist, Pablo Paulo Kilian. So let me introduce Alberto Acosta. He's an internationally renowned politician and economist from Ecuador. Let me continue introducing Alberto Acosta, even though you recognize him. He's an internationally renowned economist and politician from Ecuador. 2007 and 2008, he was the president of the Constitutional Assembly of Ecuador, and he was also the Minister for Energy and Mining, and he was a co-initiator of the new Yasuni ITT initiatives. So he is known for his activism, especially in the area of post-extractivism as well. So welcome, Alberto Acosta, and we're looking forward to your presentation.
Muy buenas noches.
And a warm welcome to all of you. I believe we can say realistically that this movement is growing, and I think that's a very positive kind of growth. But let's speak now about degrowth, about taking back or turning around economic growth. It's a great honor for me to speak to you here at this university. It's also a great challenge because there are many people here who know a great deal about the topic and who could have spoken here instead of me. So I have a great sense of responsibility. What do we want? We want to analyze the concept of degrowth. I think what degrowth entails most of all is a major transformation. There are many people here, and we know that outside of this room and outside of the city as well, there are many other people whose reality looks quite different, whose reality is not degrowth. The world over, there are many proponents of growth. Other scholars have already described this some time ago, and we can hear this in the speeches given by politicians and entrepreneurs, and we can hear it and see it in the media. When I arrived in Europe on Sunday, I read a news item about Spain. The secretary, the finance minister in Spain, or perhaps in Mexico, said that he was concerned about Mexico's economic growth not progressing as rapidly as he'd hoped for. Mexican economy had only grown by 1% as opposed to about 4%, the rate of growth seen in some Arab countries. And he was wondering how this could be. And the Mexican economy was growing so much slower than these other economies. Fortunately, we have, our economy has been growing, he said. And this almost seems to be a sort of religion that we have to keep growing. But I also read another news item in the global news magazine that I was reading. And this was a piece of a news item on Germany. It was about the possibility of an economic recession in Germany, and the article raised a question of what would happen to other European countries if there was an economic recession in Germany. A growth society that is not experiencing growth is facing a major problem, and that can lead to major catastrophes. That's something that we've witnessed in the past during various economic downturns. So from this perspective, we're always hearing the same thing. People tell us it's impossible to imagine an economic system without growth. They tell us that if there's no growth, then there is no economy. And this view is constantly reiterated. But if we limit ourselves to this view, we'll never be able to develop a different kind of debate. We won't find any solutions to the problems of poverty and of the degradation of the environment. If we want a different world, or we who would hope for a different world, we often we often go through the experience of the proponents of growth thinking that we are naive or childish. Now we've all assembled here and we want to have a debate. We want to talk about how we can change the world. This is the major challenge that we are facing. I believe that the debate that we can conduct here might be able to establish a connection between the global north and the global south. As early as 2011, I had the honor of opening a conference, the ATTAC conference, Beyond Growth. What has changed since then? I believe that most importantly, we've established connections. We're talking about the same issues. People in the global north and in the global south are debating the same issues. I believe the perspective in the north and the perspective in the south are, as it were, two sides of the same coin. But for people to really grasp this point and to understand that these different perspectives belong together, we need to clarify what exactly we're talking about. We need to get to the gist of the matter. All of us who are here, we already have an idea. We already know that the environment poses limits to growth. Since 1972, since the Club of Rome report, we know that these limits to growth exist. And the idea that the world has these limits, for example, one of the main proponents of growth has pointed out, but also Latin American political representatives have said, we are being denied the possibility to develop. If development is denied to the countries of the South, and we're being denied development because the global North has gone too far. We need social development, we need sustainability, we need sustainable development. So we started to think about how sustainability might be possible, and how the face of the Earth, what the face of the Earth would look like, and what sort of planet we would leave to future generations. And it's always the North that then always places a great deal of stock in technological solutions. And this is especially true of Germany. They're always talking about technologies that can optimize certain processes and make or help develop more environmentally friendly forms of production. So this sort of commercialization of nature has increased tremendously in recent years. And this, of course, is what is sometimes called the green economy or green growth. What seems most perverse to me is that there is the creation of a fictitious market, such as the market on carbon dioxide, the market for carbon dioxide emission certificates. And I think that there's a great deal of issues that we could pick out from this whole field of problems, and there's a great deal of things we could discuss. Now we've been speaking for several years about degrowth, about turning economic growth around, because there's not just environmental limits to growth, there's also social limits. And here I'm speaking from the perspective of the global South. We've adopted in the year 1949, we adopted this logic of economic growth when U.S. President Truman articulated the idea that the wealthy nations should help the poorer nations to overcome their underdevelopment. And people in the global South were delighted with this idea, because the idea was that if the elites in a country are doing well, then the poor will be doing well too. So we did everything we could to make growth possible in our countries. But it wasn't long before we faced the first problems. For example, we found that we weren't able to eliminate poverty or inequality. And then we had environmental problems, and gender issues turned out to be problematic as well. And also human rights issues became a problem. So this is an experience that almost all of the countries have gone through. Almost all of the countries that are unjustifiedly referred to as the so-called third world. So we had good growth rates in the 1980s. Our economies grew by 8 or 9%, and nevertheless, we weren't able to eliminate these problems that I mentioned. So people who have engaged with theories of development, they have been able to find out relatively quickly that this cannot be the solution. A professor of Columbia University in New York already spoke in 1958 about how development might lead to an intensification of work and of poverty because of the destruction of natural resources. It's clear that economic development can be a means to an end, but it can never be an end in itself or the solution in itself. And of course, for many countries, it isn't even the solution that will lead to the outcome that they wish for. Others have found out that economic development may have positive aspects, but it can also have negative aspects. It's very much a matter of what problems emerge on the level of the environment and on the level of society. I'd also like to point out, because this is something that Albert Hirschman already pointed out, one of the great theorists of economic growth, who in 1958 already said that development theory needs to be decoupled from growth theory. And this is something that we've struggled to do in the so-called third world, and we've found that the situation is constantly becoming more complex, that we haven't succeeded in achieving development in our countries, but rather we've seen a deterioration of the situation in our countries. What has development done for us? Well, in some cases, it has led to people becoming poor. It has led to people being denied the possibility of helping themselves. It has led to the destruction of communities. And it has led to a situation where large sectors of society are affected by these trends. And there's been infringements of human rights, and there's been a rise of new inequalities. And this process has, as it were, accelerated or intensified. Now, for example, we're facing the problem of the so-called new extractivism, which is very closely bound up with the dominance of capitalism and the growth paradigm. I think it would be easy to show that the so-called developed countries are in fact poorly developed. For example, the carbon footprint of the wealthy countries, it's much bigger than the planet Earth can sustain. It's completely incompatible with a functioning, healthy environment. So we need to ask ourselves the following question. We can speak of a systematic failure. We can speak, I think, of the systematic failure of a civilization and of capitalist society, which is a society that engenders inequality, that generates inequality. Eighty-five people, currently own more assets than 1.75 billion people on the planet, who number among the poorest within the world population. And these are figures I think we need to take seriously, because in some parts of the global south, I'm not just talking about the Amazon or the Andes, but other areas as well, there's an emergence of alternative movements and alternative concepts, such as, for example, the concept of buen vivir, or of the good life. So there are alternative models that are being developed. And I think they're helpful to us when we're thinking about the issue of degrowth. For example, I think we need to pay attention to the fact that degrowth always has to go hand in hand with post-extractivism. Someone from Canada already addressed the point. It's utterly perverse what is happening at the moment. At an incredible cost to the environment, there's gold mining going on in South America, and this gold mining is becoming more and more complicated, in the sense that there's more and more chemicals that are being used in the process. Every gram of gold that is mined involves more than 20 tons of pollutants being produced. So this is utterly absurd. And what happens to this gold that is being mined in this way? Well, it's the banks that profit from it, the banks that maintain the capitalist system and keep it stable. I think these are issues that we need to engage with. In the global north, there is talk about turning economic growth around. There's talk about degrowth. The communist manifesto from the year 1848 already formulated this notion, the notion that economic growth needs to be halted. And I will try to summarize the ideas expressed therein, because I think they can make a contribution to our discussion. Uh, 1848, Marx already said that one mustn't put so much stock in production. A philosopher and politician that he was, he already said this then. The fact that there are people who own more than anyone needs and who produce nothing and who thereby generate no happiness is a serious problem. And I believe we shouldn't defend people who live this way or protect them, because their wealth is based on the exploitation of others. It's based on their turning against others. And I think the example that they give to us is a bad example. So the question we need to ask ourselves is there an awareness of the fact that we need to bring about a change, or will we actually destroy the planet before we successfully change our lifestyles? The vast majority of people is subjected to the growth paradigm. Take China, for example. It's a great example, or it's presented to us as a great example of economic growth. There's constant efforts that are being undertaken to achieve greater economic growth, but there's no talk or no thinking that's put into where this will lead or where it has already led. 75% of what is produced benefits only 10% of the population. This is the logic behind economic growth. It's not just about the limits of the environment. It's also a question of the strain that is being put on societies. This is sometimes called the paradox of Stelling. You have an increase in GNP in the USA during the past 70 years. You have a constant increase of GNP, but indicators that tell us something about the happiness of citizens in the United States have not been on the rise. They've remained constant. Jürgen Schuhl has published a brilliant political scientist from Peru has published a study on Latin American countries, and he says it may be possible for economic growth for the economy to grow tremendously without this producing any benefits for the population. So this means that degrowth should help us overcome the growth paradigm. We need to leave growth societies behind. There are many scholars and academics here in Germany and in Europe who are engaging with the issues such as Latouche in Paris. I don't want to name all of their names, but there are many people who are engaging with this issue. And I'd like to conclude by saying we need to begin thinking about a different economic model. We need to begin developing a different economic model that goes back to the basics and accepts the fact that societies have needs and they have limits. There's a limit to what they can take. We are part of nature. We are nature. We are living organisms and parts of nature. We're not just a machine or a mechanism that simply works all by itself. And this is the idea that we should take as the starting point, moving away from anthropocentric thinking and from a focus purely on ourselves. We should develop a biocentric ethic. Nature has rights. Nature can be the starting point for far-reaching social change. There are many issues that society is engaging with or is having to deal with and that we shouldn't tolerate. Poverty, for example, is completely intolerable, just as hunger is. And there's always talk about an increase in the production of food. That's not necessary at all. We actually are producing enough food for everyone already. we are producing enough food, or we would be able to produce enough food for 11 billion people, even though we are far fewer people on this planet. And nevertheless, we have millions of people who go to bed hungry every night. So it's a problem of distribution. The Food and Agriculture Organization, in its reports on this issue, has also provided us with information on, for example, the enormous amount of food that is being destroyed instead of being used to feed people. There's a study that was done that says that in the USA, 40% of the foodstuffs consumed in households aren't even unpackaged, but they're thrown directly in the trash. And that's symptomatic of the throwaway society and the society of waste that we live in. We can no longer accept poverty and hunger. It's not just a question of reducing them. We have to do away with them altogether. We need to get rid of patriarchy. We need to get rid of machismo. We have to stop the ongoing processes of recolonization. When are we going to begin? It almost seems to be too late, but we do still have time. We need a vision. We need a perspective, a short-term, a medium-term, and a long-term perspective. The model needs to be adequate. But we also need a utopia. We need to have an idea of where we want to go. In the Amazon, we have the concept of buen vivir, of the good life. Maybe it would be better to phrase it in the plural, because it's a question of good lives and not of the good life in the singular. We need this sort of utopia on the horizon. We need a point on the horizon that we can use to orient ourselves. We need to know what kind of world we want to leave to future generations, and that's something that we can think about here and now. But of course, we mustn't stop there. We also need to think about concrete steps. At the same time, if we only think in concrete, practical terms, that's not enough either. We need both the utopia and the practical steps. The process of degrowth that we're striving for needs to be a democratic process. In the North and in the South, we're engaging with similar issues. We know that we must overcome the capitalist system, and we can't wait for someone to present us with some new system from above, as it were, and tell us, well, now we've solved all the problems. No, we have to do it from below. We have to do it ourselves, and that's why we're meeting here. Many additional conferences, assemblies, and meetings need to follow this conference. There are many, many people here, and they're capable of discussing and of finding solutions, but we're not going to find every solution here. The solutions are also found in the communities, and this is something that's already happening. There already are communities that are practically working to develop alternatives and to develop solutions, and we need to speak to one another and struggle to get together. We need to have an exchange on our experiences. We need to talk about our experiences, and I believe it's in our hands what the future of the world will look like. It's up to us to decide what the world that future generations live in will look like, and we will always need more democracy if we're to achieve this, not less democracy.
Thank you very much, Alberto Costa. So, our next speaker will be Nomika Kolena. Is just escorting her into the lecture hall.
At this understand there are thousands of people out there in different halls kicking to be a fantastic few days. It's a honor to follow Alba Kota, from whom I learned so much over the years and who has been such a fantastic words practice. Year. I want to thank the organizers for their very thoughtful being and friend as you have in meeting this gathering. This is that become more important as years go by. You're having the conversation of our time. One more of us will be having. Thank you for creating this big space and to get together. To get a praise of the book coming out. So, as usual, long book, and I'm going to be speaking for 2 minutes. I won't be covering. By any means, but I will say a little bit of OAC relates to themes that you need to see by reading the two epigraphs that begin the book, the two quotes that I chose to begin. One of them comes from a friend of mine who died tragically 2 years ago, a young climate leader named Rebecca Tarbottom, who was killed actually in a swimming accident in Mexico. She was the executive director of the Rainforest Action Network. And I wanted to start the book by honoring Rebecca because she is so missed within the climate justice movement, and also because she said something that I think is so important in grounding our efforts. So this is Rebecca. She says, "We need to remember that the work of our time is bigger than climate change. We need to be setting our sights higher and deeper. What we're really talking about, if we're honest with ourselves, is transforming everything about the way we live on this planet." So that's the first quote. And the second quote is from the wonderful science fiction author, Kim Stanley Robinson, and this is a quote from 2012 from Kim Stanley Robinson. He says, "In my books, I've imagined people salting the Gulf Stream, damming the glaciers sliding off the Greenland ice cap, pumping ocean water into the dry basins of the Sahara and Asia to create salt seas, pumping melted ice from Antarctica north to provide fresh water, genetically engineering bacteria to sequester more carbon in the roots of trees, raising Florida 30 feet to get it back above water, and, hardest of all, comprehensively changing capitalism. So I think that that is a great quote to think about in terms of the challenge that we face. Kim Stanley Robinson, being a science fiction writer, has imagined all of these very far-fetched sort of geoengineering techno fixes to the climate, and says this is all far easier to imagine humans doing than comprehensively changing capitalism. So we should be somewhat humble about what it is that we're trying to do. It's hard. I don't think we're under any illusions that it is not hard. So the premise that from which my book begins is one that I think we all pretty much agree on, that when it comes to addressing the climate crisis, we being humanity, the collective we, have failed catastrophically. And we're not, you know, we're not talking about theory, we're talking about the actual track record. Governments began to talk seriously about emission reductions in 1988. The first GATT negotiations began in 1990. And since that time, global carbon emissions have gone up by 61%. So that is not a track record to be proud of. It's a track record that some of our most staid and conservative institutions tell us put us on a temperature path that we'll see between 4 and 6 degrees of warming from pre-industrial levels if we do nothing, so by end of century. So we're on that path, according to the World Bank, according to the International Energy Agency, according to PricewaterhouseCoopers. So this is not a left-wing conspiracy. This is what these conservative sources are telling us will happen if we just keep doing exactly what we're doing now. So the way we get there is nothing. It is by doing nothing, and that's why I call the book "This Changes Everything," because status quo is not an option. We either face the radical future of everything about our physical world changing, or we fundamentally change our economy in the kind of ways that Kim Stanley Robinson and Rebecca Tarbottom were suggesting. But radical change of some kind, whether physical or political, are our only options left. And this is why I think that the climate crisis challenges centrist liberals most of all, because they subscribe to an ideology that is so resistant to the idea of radical change, to the idea of anything but incremental, reformist change. So given that we can, I think, accept as a premise that we have failed and that we do admit this, there are a lot of theories floating around about why this is, and sometimes, you know, the UN is blamed, sometimes human nature is blamed. The argument that I put forward in the book is that it's actually a lot more simple, that our failure, most of all, has to do with the tragic bad timing of this particular crisis. Because if you think about it, while scientists have understood the link between carbon emissions and warming, there's been consensus around it since the 50s and 60s. The issue hit the mainstream in the late 80s. The real turning point in North America was when James Hansen testified before the U.S. Congress and said that he had a high degree of certainty that there was this link between emissions and warming, and that the process had already begun. This is when it hit the mainstream. So if you think about that timing, I think particularly in the German context, you know, this is 1988. What else is happening in the world in 1988? Well, 1 year later, the Berlin Wall collapses. History is declared over. This is the triumph of of the neoliberal moment, of pensée unique, of there is no alternative. How this relates to climate change is an issue that I think has been under-discussed and under-studied. So what I try to do in the first part of the book is show very concretely how the triumph of the neoliberal ideology has systematically sabotaged the actions that were needed to respond to this crisis. So just to sort of run down a few obvious examples. One is free trade or globalization, the policies that were locked in free trade agreements in this period, the creation of the World Trade Organization, which took place simultaneous to the beginnings of the climate negotiations. These were two parallel international negotiations going on that sort of pretended that the other one didn't exist because they were ultimately irreconcilable. And where I live in Toronto, where I'm speaking to you from Toronto, Ontario, and here we've had an experience that that makes this very concrete. Ontario passed one of the most progressive emission reduction plans in the world and the most ambitious in North America in the midst of the economic crisis in 2009. This was a plan to phase out coal completely and switch to renewable energy. It was modeled actually on example with feed-in tariffs. And it was also, the way trade unions were brought on board and the way it was sold to the public was that it would be a huge job creator for an ailing manufacturing sector, particularly because the auto industry was in collapse in this period. So the plan included within it a very ambitious and I consider a very important a requirement that in order to be eligible for the subsidies that were part of the feed-in tariff, for the supports that were part of the feed-in tariff, energy providers, green energy providers, had to source between 40 and 60% of their equipment, of their manufacturing locally. So they had to create local, to open solar manufacturing plants. They had to open plants manufacturing wind turbines. They had to create local jobs. What happened next is that Japan and then the European Union challenged this under the World Trade Organization and brought Canada before a trade tribunal at the WTO, which ruled against Ontario, which ruled that, in fact, these requirements that local industry be created was an unfair discrimination to international firms. Now, Canada could have challenged this aggressively, but of course Canada didn't want to challenge it aggressively because we have a right-wing government that's eating up the Alberta tar sands, not in building renewable energy. So this was allowed to stand, and it has been an incredibly dangerous precedent. So that's just one example of the sensible, common sense things that we know we have to do to respond to this crisis, as if it is the emergency that it is actually illegal under these structures that we have created. So that's one example of this clash between neoliberalism and the imperatives of the climate crisis. The most obvious is the way in which the logic of austerity that has so gripped Europe, particularly Southern Europe, but not only Southern Europe, clashes with the need for us to invest in a visionary way, in a bold way, in the public sector, both to prepare for the inevitable extreme weather that is already upon us, and also to lower our emissions. So everything from building that smart grid infrastructure, investing massively in public transit and ensuring that it's affordable to all, and just being ready when disaster strikes. So we've seen this clash in Greece, which is very vulnerable to forest fires, and where the firefighters are so broke that they can't afford to buy spare tires for their fire trucks as they're going in to fight fires. And we saw it recently in Britain, where there was historic flooding in the UK last year, and David Cameron, sort of Mr. Austerity himself, was caught flat-footed because he had completely gutted the environmental agency that was responsible for responding to extreme weather, including flooding. And this was not suddenly very popular. And so he announces that Money is no object in our response to the floods. So you see in these moments glimpses of how the logic of austerity and the reality of climate disruption are really incompatible. So that's one example, but I think the even more tragic one is the way in which so many of our governments in the global north have refused to rise to our responsibility to support governments of the global south to respond to a crisis that was not of their creation. We live in a time when our governments are clawing back all of their foreign aid commitments. And the idea that they might recognize their climate debts is considered so crazy that it isn't even discussed in our society. So that's I think the most important way in which the logic of austerity is undermining what we must do to respond to the climate crisis. Because of course anyone who pays attention to the climate negotiations at the UN level knows that the negotiations break down every time over the refusal of northern governments to live up to our historical responsibility, I mentioned. And it gets worse, not better, every year as the so-called the economy is pitted against the environment again and again. You guys will have to give me some sort of signal if my if I'm breaking up, because you're breaking up a little bit in what I'm able to see. Everything's fine? Yeah. Everything's fine. Another really vivid example, and because you guys are all in Germany, I'll talk about is the way in which our responses to the climate crisis, sensible responses, necessary responses, conflict directly with the neoliberal orthodoxy, has to do with privatization and explicitly with privatization of our energy grids, of our energy utilities. And I raise this with a German audience, but in fact it's a large part of my book because I think it's one of the most dramatic examples of this. Now, in Germany, as you all know, is in the midst of probably the most dramatic, and I think inspiring energy transition in the world. Now sees 25% of the country's electricity coming from renewable energy, most of it wind and solar, but most exciting of all, much of it decentralized, much of it coming from energy co-ops, much of it coming from locally controlled new energy utilities. The piece of this picture that has been really underreported outside of Germany is that a great deal of this was only possible because hundreds of municipalities in Germany have decided to take back control over their energy grids from private operators. And this is true in small towns, but now there is a vote in Munich to take back control over the grid, which is extraordinary. And we know that residents in Berlin overwhelmingly agree and want to do the same thing, and with any luck, will find a way. So this is a really vivid example of how people are coming to the conclusion that the interests of private players who've taken over the energy grids and the interests of the public to be part of this transformation are simply at odds. The profit motive is sabotaging these fantastic efforts. And this is starting to spread to North America, where you have cities like Boulder, Colorado, voting to take back control over their grid. But the other thing that Germany, I know I'm sort of making the Germans feel good about themselves, and there should be some of that, but we have to rein it in a little bit. Because of course there's bad news out of Germany too, which is that in the midst of this remarkable transformation, emissions are actually going up and have gone up for the past couple of years. How is this possible? And the reason why it's possible is because it isn't just enough to put some good incentives in place and to say yes to good programs. We also have to have governments that are willing to say no to the fossil fuel companies. And in Germany, that hasn't happened. Coal is still king, particularly lignite, coal, which is, you know, the dirtiest of all the fossil fuels. And so you have this completely contradictory policy of investing in wind and solar renewable energy on the one hand, and allowing coal use to expand and coal exports to expand. And this, by the way, is also linked to free trade, because it becomes harder and harder to regulate the export of fossil fuels. So when our governments fail to live up to their responsibilities, and this, of course, is also part of that same neoliberal agenda, because our governments don't know how to say no anymore. They've lost that skill. So what we have is the grassroots stepping in. And this is happening all over the world. In my country, it's happening around tar sands, anti-pipeline activism. Around the world, it's happening with resistance to fracking. We've seen incredible, I know Alberto Acosta has talked about the Yasuni case, which is really the grassroots saying no, leave it in the ground. And now I think we're going to see a ramping up of this in Germany in the coming year, focused on Europe's CO2 hotspot, which is the West German lignite mining region around Cologne, where I think we're going to see a ramping up of direct action, taking aim at this carbon choke point, because we have to find these choke points on all of our continents, in each of our countries, and we have to squeeze. And this is happening, and I think that this is what sets this moment apart, is that it isn't just about, you know, dropping out and building our alternatives and talking about our perfect degrowth future. And it isn't just about confronting the carbon criminals. We have to do both at the same time. We have to have our resistance and our alternatives woven together. And I think more and more of us understand that. And so I really want to salute the activists who are planning those actions against lignite in the coming months, and hope that you all will join them. I've just got a couple of minutes to wrap up, and I just want to just tie this in, of course, with the theme of this conference, which is about degrowth. Because, you know, I've talked about how this is a challenge to neoliberalism, but the response to this is not, okay, we can go back to the 1970s, the pre-Reagan, pre-Thatcher, and we can just have a more regulated Keynesian form of capitalism. It's too late for that. That ship has sailed. Kevin Anderson and Alice Bowes from the Tyndall Center have laid this out so clearly, that for those of us in the global north, what we need to be doing in the next decade is lowering our emissions by between 8 and 10% a year, if we want to have a 50-50 chance of keeping global temperatures below 2 degrees warming, which is already a dangerous target. If we are going to do that, it is not compatible with economic growth. It's impossible. The only time we've ever seen emission drops on that level were in the years immediately following the Great Depression. Anybody claiming there is such a thing as green growth, that decoupling is possible, has not looked hard at these numbers. If we had 50 years to play with, maybe, but not if we have 10 years to play with, which is what we have. So given that we don't want to crash like the Great Depression, what we need to do is have a deliberate economy. That's an economy that grows in the areas that are light on the earth, the caring professions, caregiving, teaching, the arts, that expands in how we treat each other, and contracts when it comes to the mindless use of resources, particularly finite resources. So that's the task ahead. And I'm convinced that climate change represents a historic opportunity for us to live up to these dreams. Many of them, dreams we've had, the movements on whose shoulders we stand, have been dreaming about for hundreds of years. As part of the project of getting our emissions down to the levels many scientists recommend, we once again have the chance to advance policies that dramatically improve lives, close the gap between rich and poor, create huge numbers of good jobs, and reinvigorate democracy from the ground up. Rather than the ultimate example of what I've called the shock doctrine, a frenzy of new resource grabs and repression, climate change can be a people's shock, a blow from below. It can disperse power from the hands of the many to the hands of the many, rather than consolidating it into the hands of the few. It can radically expand the commons rather than auctioning it off in pieces. And where right-wing shock doctors exploit emergencies, both real and manufactured, in order to push through policies that make us even more prone to crisis, the kinds of transformations that we must fight for do the exact opposite. They would get to the root of why we are facing serial crises, both economic and ecological, in the first place, and would lead with a more habitable climate than the one we are headed for, and an economy that is far better than the one we have right now. Underneath all of this is the truth that I think we do know, that climate change isn't an issue to add to the list of things to worry about next to healthcare and taxes. It is a civilizational wake-up call, a powerful message spoken in the language of fires, floods, droughts, and extinctions, telling us that we need an entirely new economic model, a new way of sharing the planet, telling us that we need to evolve. Thank you, and enjoy the conference.
Große Unruhe ausbricht, möchte ich euch noch einladen, weiter zu bleiben. Wir haben jetzt noch einen längeren musikalischen Beitrag.
We're going to hear a longer piece of music now. And I'd like to ask Pablo and Melody to jump to us. Thank you.
Vielen Dank. Wer die beiden nochmal sehen möchte und auch ein bisschen länger, ist herzlich eingeladen, am Donnerstag in der Mittagspause nochmal in den Hörsaal zu kommen.
Minute break, and then we'll continue with the opening panel, and we would be glad if you choose to stay and listen to us discuss why so many movements feel a sense of affinity with degrowth. See you in a quarter of an hour.